was shining bright through the sycamores for me.
Welcome to the town of Akron, Indiana. This video was created to tell you about our town today and to tell you about some of its history. Was created by Mrs. McFarland's fourth grade class in May of 2000 as part of a project for Indiana history.
Welcome to Akron, Indiana!
In the year of 1836, a small party of rugged pioneers left their homes in Medina County, Ohio, in search of a new life in the West. Indiana had been admitted to statehood 20 years earlier, and it offered a new frontier to be homesteaded. The group was led by Dr. Joseph Sippy, who had prospected the area a year earlier. The settlers brought household items, tools, seeds, and they drove pigs, sheep, and a cow. When they came to a place that the two Indian trails crossed, which is now State Road 14 and 19, Dr. Sippy proclaimed, "This is the place." Today, the Akron United Methodist Church stands at this spot. The people were able to give thanks for a safe month's journey that was marked by river crossings, Indians, and the hard labor of clearing their own trails. The group included 47 members, the families of Dr. Sippy, Asher Welton, William Wittenberger, Moses Warden, Henry Bristol, and Alfred Bragg. When the town was platted in 1838 by Dr. Sippy and Hiram Welton, it was named Newark. It wasn't officially named Akron until January 1, 1855. The first church in Akron was this crude structure. It was destroyed by fire in 1869. W.F. Strong remembered seeing music written on the building's walls by Mrs. N.C. Hall for the soldiers who had gone to battle in the Civil War. The people in this picture are Dr. Harder, L. Blair, Andrew Strong, Jacob Wittenberger, and his son Charles. The second church, built on the Methodist corner, was the frame structure. It was dedicated in 1863, and its total cost with furniture, stoves, and bell was $1,328.39. Ruby Dawson recalls that it had two front doors, one for men and one for women. As reported in the Akron News by editor Sam Scheschler in 1903, Akron had grown to 700 residents. It boasted a telephone system, school building, four churches, two jewelers, two millinery stores, two blacksmith shops, two harness stores, two saloons, a pickle factory, a milk station and creamery, a furniture and undertaking store, two banks, a veterinarian, two general stores, two grocery stores, two drug stores, a shoe cobbler, a livery stable, a grist mill, a brick and tile factory, seven lodges, a tin shop, a grain elevator, a hotel, a restaurant, a broom and basket factory, and a meat market. It had two barber shops, a newspaper and job office, a hay press, one brass band, five ministers, five Sunday schools, four physicians, a dentist, two hardware stores, a cider mill, five carpenters, one timber buyer, five stock buyers, a justice of the peace, a constable, a labor yard, a commissioned high school, and it boasted 12 veterans and two rural mail carriers. As the years progressed, Akron was incorporated and elected a town board. A businessmen's group was formed and met weekly for lunch at the Hotel Akron. Some of the town's businesses from 1927 to 1963 included Akron Ford Motor Sales, Henry Meredith's Filling Station, Akron Motor Company, a hardware, drugstore, and doctor's office, as well as Leininger & Sons Variety Store. In the ensuing years, while the total number of Akron businesses has diminished, overall living standards have improved, with police, fire, and ambulance service, paved streets, and improved schools. In the next segment, we would like to share interviews with some of our townspeople. Our first interview was with Miss Velma Bright. She is considered one of our town's historians, and she shared the history of the library and services offered today.
How old is the library?
Well, the library was established in 1912, where they had to, where they had a library in an upstairs room downtown, and they organized it. But the building then, they had to have an organized building before the Carnegie Foundation would give them any money to build a building. So in 1914, they laid the cornerstone, and it was finished in October 1915. This was 1912 when they started the library. But through that era then, people began to get automobiles, and this place went out of business, and the people in the township and the town had to raise the money to buy a lot to put the library on, and then the Carnegie Foundation would pay for the building and everything in it, but they wouldn't pay for the lot, and then the people had to sign a petition that they would forever keep the building up and the library with taxation.
How many books do you have?
Well, we have 26,582 books, besides a lot of other things, videos, audio books, and different things like that. And people borrow videos. We have audio books, which are talking books. I mean, you can put them in a cassette, you know. They are cassettes, and you put them in, and you can hear the story of the book. These are mainly for adults, really, because some adults cannot see well, or some like to do this when they're traveling, put it, so that they can hear the story. And then we have computers. We are on the internet. We also have two computers that are not on the internet. One is mainly for the catalog. And the other is if you want to do a term paper, if you want to do some report at school or something and you want to type it out.
The second interview is with Mr. Brett Boggs, the Akron Elementary School principal. He shared information on the history of Akron School.
Hi, I'm Megan Meiser, and I'm interviewing Mr. Boggs. How old is Akron School?
Megan, I had to do a little research on this because I didn't have the answer to that question. There's been a school in Akron for a long, long time. I know that before the old high school building was built in 1912, that there was a school located in the southern part of town down near the library. And as I understand it, that school was there for a long time. The Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation, of which we're a part, was formed in 1962. And at that time, here at Akron, we had an elementary school of grades K to 5, and we also had a high school of grades 9 through 12, and then there was a junior high school at Beaver Dam. In 1975, the new Tippecanoe Valley High School was built, and that was when Akron became a K through 8 building. We had grades K through 8. And then in 1987, the new junior high building, which is the building that we're in right now, was built, and the old high school building was tore down. So that building was there from 1912 until 1987. In 1995, the new middle school was built, and that's when this school became a K through 5 school.
When was the playground built?
Okay, I did a little research there because I wasn't real sure. But many of the items that are on the playground right now were moved when this building was built. Right where you're sitting right now in this part of the building used to be the playground. And many of those pieces of playground equipment had to be moved from this location out onto the playground. So they were moved in 1987. Disneyland was installed a couple years after that in 1989, as were the basketball goals and the merry-go-round and the benches that are outside. The fitness course was added. Our parent support group and several people in the community helped us put that in 1990. And then the playground that we just put in behind Mrs. Krieger's room for the real little kids, the primary playground, that was obviously built in 2000.
Next, we spoke with Mrs. Penny Heisey, manager of the Norwest Wells Fargo Branch Bank in Akron. This bank evolved from the Akron Exchange State Bank. She talked with us about the bank and the recent move of the post office to the bank building.
Hi, my name is Eddie Ewing.
And my name is Jordan Schultz.
And we are going to interview Mrs. Penny Heisey. How long has the bank been here?
Akron Exchange State Bank has been in Akron since 1891. And it was actually located down on the corner where Lake City Bank is now. We moved into this building in 1977.
Why did you put the bank and post office together?
Well, as you all know, computers and technology can really help to downsize the amount of work that you have to do. And when we became Norwest, a lot of our operations are done off-site, so we didn't need like a bookkeeping department here, and it decreased the staff that we needed to keep here in this office. So we were using this big, large building to house roughly 5 employees. So we seen that we could be more cost efficient if we was to downsize our facility and allow the post office to come to be with us. And it's helped the community and it's helped our bank grow too.
Thank you.
Our next stop was the Tom Holloway Barbershop. Tom is seen being interviewed by his granddaughter, Erin Gelbaugh.
Hi, my name is Erin Gelbaugh.
I'm on trip, all right.
And we're going to interview Tom Holloway for the barbershop. How many years has the barbershop been here?
Since 1963. So that makes about 37 years. I've been in here.
How many customers do you have each week?
I cannot give you a good answer on that. Some weeks I'm busier than others, so it varies. When it rains, then all the farmers come to town, and I'm busy one week. And then when it's sunshiny, nobody's in town. Like this morning, they're all out mowing yard.
What was here before the barbershop started?
There was a lady, Mrs. Kuhn, lived here in Akron, and she had a dress shop in here, a small dress shop. And they had racks around here, and it was rather small for a dress shop, but that's what was in here before I came.
Was there a barber shop in Akron before you?
Yeah, I think there's always been a barber shop in Akron. When I came here, there was a barber shop across the street from me. And then there was one up here where Mrs. Bowers, you know, the beauty lady, there was a barber in there, and his name was Beanie Wechter. And he had barbered in Akron, I believe, 50 years. So us old barbers, we never retire. We just keep working.
How much do you think hairstyles have changed in the past years?
That's interesting. When I first started, everybody got short haircuts like this boy's, that or flat tops. So when I first begun, everybody wanted short hair. And then the hippies came in, and everybody let their hair get down to their shoulders then. But now then, it has come back, everybody, well, not everybody, but most people, the boys, they want short hair again. So in 41 years, it's kind of made a circle and the barber pole. Years ago, barber shops, probably back in the 1800s maybe, you would go to the barber and he was a surgeon, he'd done some surgery. And they done something they called bloodletting. People thought it was healthy. They would go in, and I think they had leeches. You know what leeches are? And they would put leeches on their patients or customers, and they would draw out some blood. But then they would have some bleeding, or if they done some minor surgery. So the red on the barber pole signifies blood. And then the white signifies bandages that they use to wrap the wound. And it's interesting, does anybody have a guess what the blue represents? No. Dentistry. The barbers used to pull teeth. So the blue signifies a dentist place. So that's kind of interesting on the history of the barber pole. Okay.
We spent some time touring the Pike Memorial Park with Channing Utter, president of Pike Lumber Company. His family donated the land presently used for the park.
Hi, I'm Chastity and this is Matthew. We're going to interview Mr. Utter. How old is the park?
Well, the park was started in 1955, so that would make it how old? 45 years old.
Who built the park?
Several people did over many years. My mother, whose maiden name was Pike, started the park back in 1955, and she carried it up through 1974. In 1974, we organized a park board, and our park board, along with the Akron Little League, built the Little League park. Okay, and you're involved over here, and this was at that time called the Little League, and they were involved in that project. That was built by volunteers and a lot of contributions from the community. The shelter house that you're standing in was built by the Akron Jonas Club, and if you look up on the wall, you'll see a plaque dated 1980. And most of you kids can't remember the Jonas Club, but some of your parents can, because they were famous for their fish fries. Over on the other side of the park, you will see what is called Miller Wood. And Miller Woods was contributed by the Miller family. Dr. Charles Miller and his wife and children contributed that in memory of his parents, Dr. Virgil Miller and May Miller. Kappa Delta Phi sorority in the early 90s was very instrumental in building a portion of the park. They built a lot of the playground equipment that you'll find over when we take our little walking tour of the park. Any of you kids on the Pride Council? Okay. Then you know that you raised money for the benches here in the park. So all of this is part of what the Pride Council has done. And that is, all of these benches that you see constructed were built by the Pride Council. The Fulton County Community Foundation in about the mid-90s was very instrumental in construction of the new basketball courts. Other than that, most of this has been done over the last 45 years by a whole lot of volunteers in the town of Akron. In many cases, I imagine it might have been your mothers and fathers, probably was your grandmothers and grandfathers. The community built the park.
Marty Gerhardt, a 16-year employee of the town of Akron, gave us some history of the town's present lagoon system. We were also able to walk back and see the lagoons and lift station. Akron has received a recent grant to build a wetlands to help correct flooding caused by rain overflow. It will be located in the original bed of Town Lake.
I am Chris Fisher, and this is Marty Gerhardt. We're going to ask him some questions. Why did you decide to build a lagoon?
And years ago, when the town was established, they had sewer systems in town that went to a ditch that went to a lake. And in all the years of the town growing and the state regulations came about, that they were forced into putting in some type of a treatment plant facility. And that's when they expanded the sewers through the whole town and they built their lagoon system in about 1970.
How does it work and where does the sewage go?
It works something like a septic tank, except for it's a lot larger and it's not underground. It has an aerobic biological means of treating, which is through the air and sun, which evaporates the water, and then it also settles out to the bottom, and over a period of time, there's two lagoon cells back there. The first one's a primary and the second one's a secondary. After it goes through both lagoon cells, it's discharged into a creek, and then from there it goes to the Tippecanoe River.
How big is the lagoon?
Lagoons cover 11.4 acres, and they will hold 11,200,000 gallons of water.
What do you do in your job?
In my job, we're responsible for maintaining the sewer lines, which is cleaning them about once a year, maintaining the lift stations, which pump the sewage back to lagoons, and we, in the summer months, we mow and trim and maintain the property that the lagoons are on, plus the, and the lift stations.
Later, we paid a visit to our new town hall and fire station. Mr. Joe Day, local businessman, a volunteer fireman, and lifetime Akron resident, gave us a tour and talked with us about some of the town's history.
What one is it on?
That's right there. My grandpa was on the town board when they bought that in 1963. They delivered that on the Erie Railroad. Delivered it on a flat car and unloaded it down by Pike Lumber Company. That's, 37 years old. And if you look down where those boys are sitting, you'll see my name on it because my grandpa had the same name that I had. I'm the fourth generation in my family to have a business uptown. My dad had the hardware before I did. And we weren't always where we are now. You guys know where the flower shop is?
Yeah.
Across from Anne Marie's. When I was 11, 12, we lived above that store and the hardware was downstairs. And that's where the hardware was when we bought it. And that was in 1963 when that truck was brand new. My mom's dad, his name was Joe Bidwell. He had a grocery store uptown in the 30s and 40s, down where Ray Doring has his TV repair shop. And then, you heard him talking about my grandpa, Joe. I said his name was on that truck over there. His dad had a harness shop in about three locations uptown. One where the barber shop is, and before the 20s, he had a harness shop. The downtown Akron's where it has always been where it is, just about the size that it is now. With this fire station here, where there was a house, there were no businesses really outside the downtown area unless there was like a stable or a dray or a grist mill. Streets weren't always called what they are called now. The street that goes by the barbershop was called Gilead Avenue. And that used to be the parade route on Memorial Day as they turned south down that street on their way to the cemetery, because the town's old cemetery is down by the where you turn off to go to Pike's, down by where the railroad tracks used to be. You guys ever been through that cemetery down there? Well, it's really old, really old. And he came here in 1840.
The class then visited with Mr. Art Craig at the Akron Church of God. He talked with us about its history and recent renovation.
My name's Coda Wallace, and
I'm Tyler Ford.
Tyler Ford.
And we're gonna ask Art Craig some questions. How old is the church?
This church, not this particular church here, but this church originated. Do you know where Beaver Dam is?
Mm-hmm.
The old school. that's where the first church was in the early 1800s, and then 1881, they moved just a quarter of a mile down the road and built a brick church on the corner where there is a stone there depicting where the church was. And that was 1881, and then in 1892, they built a church out northwest of Akron called Olive Bethel. Do you know where that is? Well, it's out in the country. Your folks probably know where it is. And then they established a church there, which is still there and active. And then in 1914 or in that vicinity, they built this church, which is not this one, but they've added on, remodeled, and so forth.
When was the church built?
This original church was about between, I forget the exact dates, between 1940 and 1920. It was a wood structure. I'll show you how the original first church looked. This is how the first original Church of God here in Akron looked. And ever since then, the congregation has grown, and they have to add on and so forth. And then in 1996, we added this new addition on here, which when we get done here, I'll show it to you.
How has the church changed during the years?
Well, that's a good question. It has changed. The biggest change is, of course, I'm not old enough to know how it was back in the early days, but the big thing I noticed is the dressing, the people dressing, wearing earrings and beads. But the basic knowledge is still the same.
How long have you been a member here?
I've been a member since 1947. That'd be about 53 years. The main, most important thing, I think, is the brightness. It's not dull. It's it's cheery, and it makes the people cheery, too. You always have some deadpans every place, but that's the main thing. It's nice and light, and nice accommodations, and not ashamed to bring anybody in and show it to them. Very nice.
Our last interview and tour was with Mrs. Ann Allen, member and historian of the Akron United Methodist Church.
Hi, I'm Kyle Wade, and I'm going to interview Mrs. Allen. How long have you been a member of the church?
Oh, almost 50 years, not quite. I was younger when I joined.
How old is the church?
This particular building is 97 years old. There has been a church here since 1836. The first church was a very ramshackle thing, but all of the people who settled Akron were Methodists. So at one point, the town was actually known as Wesley Station because it was a station on Wesley's church. And then when it became too small, they built another one. And the church had a special significance during the Civil War. There weren't newspapers, so they rang the bell to notify people of what was happening. And they knew and they rang the bell a lot to tell people when somebody had died. So the church has been here a long time.
How long did it take to build the church?
I think after they actually started building this church, it didn't take very long. It took them longer to get enough money. They had a hard time getting money, and they ended up selling the lot next door to the man who built the church, and there was a hotel that was there for many years, and it's just been a few years ago that the church bought the hotel back and tore it down, and that's the reason we have some that area out there.
At first, how many people came to the church?
Well, everybody in town, because they were all Methodists, but there were seven families in the beginning. So that was about 46 people, I think. And then it's grown and grown over the years. I know you go to the Church of God, and I bet you didn't know that the Church of God started in this church. They needed a place to have a meeting to form a new church, so the Methodists let them meet here. And the Church of God actually started here. But it's a nice church. It's a family church.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We hope you have enjoyed your tour of our town, Akron, Indiana. We are proud of our community, its history, and the people.
Still hayseed enough to say, look who's in the big town. But my baby.